And now to our Know Your Car spot, and since I've no doubt you are already thinking of such seasonal additions as antifreeze, this week we are looking at the whole of the car's cooling system.
Every motor car engine has a correct working temperature. If you overcooled this engine, say by eternally throwing buckets of cold water over it, you wouldn't be doing it any good at all. It would run all the time, like your car does first thing on a cold winter's morning. It would cough and sputter and not produce full power. Equally, if you didn't cool it enough, what would happen is that the metal parts within the engine would get hot, expand, and ultimately the engine would seize up. Very expensive business indeed. Now, part of the cooling of an engine, as we showed you last week, is achieved by the circulation of the oil, conducting heat away from the warmer parts. But for all practical purposes, what concerns us are the two basic systems of engine cooling. Firstly, the system used on cars like the Volkswagen Beetle and most motorbikes, air cooling. Simply air passing over the cylinder block will cool it down, and providing the access of that air isn't impaired, all will be well. But what concerns far and away the majority of us is the other system, water cooling. Here on this model, you can see a cutaway side view of a typical cooling system. Here, the radiator, and at the bottom of the radiator, a delivery pipe which takes the coolant through into the cylinder block. And the block itself is drilled through with these waterways through which the coolant passes, expanding upwards as it heats, and passing along here back into the radiator where cooling, it gradually falls again to the bottom. But what I haven't yet mentioned is this device. For modern cooling systems don't just rely on the convection characteristics of hot water, they drive it through the system with a water pump. And that means that the system runs under pressure and is therefore more efficient. To increase the efficiency still further, designers came up with the thermostat there. And the thermostat is quite simply a valve. What happens is that that valve remains closed until this coolant here in the engine block reaches the correct working temperature, having started the car. Only then it opens like this, allowing the coolant to circulate through and bring the radiator into play, bringing the rest of the coolant circulating into the system. Now let's look at some of the parts on a full-size engine. Here on the cutaway cylinder block, you can see the waterways. There's one of them there, coloured light blue. Meanwhile, at the other end, here the thermostat. In the thermostat housing, this pipe, by the way, takes the coolant back into the top of the radiator from the block. The thermostat, when taken out, looks like this, and in there is an operating fluid, which is either alcohol or it can be wax. But most important, if you do have occasion to change a thermostat, make sure you get the right one for your car. Here's a new one in a packet. If you're going to change it yourself, it only applies to the cars listed on there. It won't fit everything. Also, on this block, the fan, which also assists in cooling by forcing warm air away from the block. In this case, it's run by a fan belt running off the crankshaft. And one possible cause of overheating is if this fan belt is too slack, because obviously then the fan won't work properly. On lots of modern cars today, the fan is electrically operated and only begins to come into action when the engine has reached the proper operating temperature. But now let's look at the radiator end. From the top of the radiator, an overflow pipe which takes away any excess coolant which is expanded through heating. And I've particularly chosen this transverse engine 1100 setup here because the overflow pipe does not just distribute that excess coolant onto the road, but down here into an expansion tank. And it will stay there until the cylinder block cools down sufficiently for that excess coolant to be sucked back up the pipe by the vacuum effect. If you have a system fitted with an expansion tank, you should check the level of the coolant down here in the expansion tank as well as up here at the top of the radiator, if indeed at the top of the radiator there is a cap you can take off to check the level. Another interesting point, if you have to check the level and you've got a hot engine, don't just take that cap off. Remember, it's a pressurized system. You'll almost certainly get scalded. There's a correct way to do that. Get a cloth over the top and slowly turn the radiator cap. You will hear it hiss as the pressure is released. When it's finished hissing, then take the top off and check the level. Remember, if the engine is hot and you require more water in the system, don't put freezing cold water in. Never put cold water into a hot engine. You can warp the cylinder head. Try and find hot water, or better still, wait for the engine to cool down. If you have to replace the radiator cap, remember, there's a spring in here. There are two valves and a spring, and that spring is absolutely set for your particular make of car. So again, going back to the new one on the card, make sure that your make of car is listed there. It's got to be the right one. Other tips, the hoses. Nothing lasts forever. Hoses can crack, they can lose flexibility. At the first sign of that, replace them. And when you've done it, don't do the clips up too tight because you'll cut through the hose and put yourself back to square one. It's also a good idea to drain and flush the whole cooling system out regularly because it can get rusty and sludgy. And when you've done that at this time of the year, it's a very good idea to put in some antifreeze. Now, there are two types of antifreeze, methanol and ethylene glycol. Methanol is cheaper, but it's inflammable and it evaporates. Ethylene glycol is more expensive, but it's also more stable. Tips with antifreeze, you'll find the correct mixture to use either in your vehicle's handbook or on the side of the tin. Don't spill neat antifreeze on the paintwork. Neat antifreeze can make a pretty nasty job of taking cellulose straight off, or at best, it will mark your car's paint. Remember, too, there is a special antifreeze for aluminium engines. There are quite a few recap tips on the subject of cooling, because remember, an efficient cooling system will not only save you money in terms of repair bills, but of course it will also make the engine itself more efficient, and so it will save you money in terms of running costs. So here's the first. Check the level of coolant in your radiator or expansion tank every day if possible. The correct level will be found in the vehicle handbook. The thermostat should be checked before the onset of winter, and your garage will advise you on this one. The cooling system should be drained and flushed at least once a year, preferably in spring. Keep a regular eye on the condition of hoses and replace them if they're cracking or getting hard. And make sure that the fan belt is correctly tensioned. And, a good idea, this. Why not carry a spare? Antifreeze, get the right type for your engine and be sure to get the correct mix of antifreeze and water. Filling it with pure antifreeze in this country would be a complete waste of money.
Well, thank heavens it doesn't get as cold here as it does in some Scandinavian countries, where in winter the poor motorists have to leave the engine running while they go shopping just to stop everything coming to a freezing halt.